solution for social protection. So it, I think it leads us to the second question of our debate concerning the social protection of self-employed people. So we have, of course, a position of the European Commission about that, very briefly. And basically, we can see that there are different options, once again, that have been reminded by my brother a few minutes ago. So basically, the universalistic solution, so a universal social protection for everyone, whatever the status. Or a system in which you have a basis, basic social protection, and a possibility of opting depending on your individual choice or the support you receive from unions, from associations, and so on. Or you can have a combination of these different systems. So what could be, in your view, the ideal situation in terms of better social protection for self-employed?
Okay. So there's another, there's a good thing I explained already what recommendations are, because there's another recommendation of the ILO recommendation for two on social protection floors, and that gives you already the, a little bit the ILO position. So you have, so the ILO's idea is, so you have a universal system, a floor, but then, so that, that so everybody is covered, but then, but that generally just provides with basic coverage, so you need more. So you have a floor, but then you need to allow for mechanisms that would increase the level. So you have universal coverage, but then you also have to work on the level that you have. And there, social insurance would be very important.
Primarily based, or
so there, I don't think that the ILO has a, I'm not the social protection department. I don't think we have a particular view on it. I think it's more important that. It's not just formal coverage, but effective access. So, for instance, if you think of a situation where social protection would be mandatory, but the threshold would be so high that it would really not be possible for self-employed, that would certainly not be something that we would go for. On the other hand, if everything is voluntary and it's just an opt-in, that would also not be the ideal situation from an ideal perspective, because you would like everyone to have access to healthcare. Child benefits, maternity protection, etc. And actually, the ILO looks at social protection in four ways. So there's social protection that's linked to your residency status, so that would be your social assistant, disability benefits, child benefits. Then you have a social protection that is linked to gainful employment, which is where self-employed fall under. So that could be that's social insurance, that's access to healthcare, pensions. But often it has this for self-employed, it has this threshold. Then you have social protection that is linked to salaried employment, so your job, you have a job, therefore whatever you're entitled to maternity protection, you're entitled to leave, that you have pension. So that's if you're, but you can, if you change jobs, you will take with you these kind of rights. And then you have a specific social protection that is linked actually to your contract, so that could be, for instance, sick leave, that your employer is directly responsible for the liability for maternity protection. So you have these kind of four dimensions, and there's employment is self-employed, and then the question is, okay, how can you make it more effective for the self-employed to participate? And actually the ILO, I'm also telling you, the ILO produced a report on non-standard employment around the world, and so that's the office that has produced the report. That's not necessarily an agreement by all our members. And there they propose some, well, they reflect upon some more innovative or progressive options. And one is, for instance, that if I stress, they say, okay, maybe the future is so that you move between employment statuses. So maybe for part of your life you're self-employed, but maybe then you have a job for 2 years and then you move back to self-employment. So the portability of the rights and the entitlements that you have, that would be a key issue. And the transferability. And then there's one proposal, but again, it's not an ideal position, that is, for instance, what if you had, rather than, for instance, an unemployment insurance, you had like an employment insurance, and that's kind of an account that is not linked to your job, but linked to you as an individual, and that you can build up, for instance, for training. So it's not linked. So often, when you're employed, you have access to training, but when you're unemployed, you lose it. So essentially, you would have kind of an individual account. I think France has established something like this, so they don't say, the ILO doesn't say this is the way forward, it's just different options. And then I just wanted to make another point. I'm struck, so the ILO work in also many developing countries, and just the whole discussion about how self-employed workers can be organized and how can they get access to social protection, there's a lot of similarities to how developing countries try to organize informal workers, the workers in the shadow economies. So how can you get waste pickers in India to have access to healthcare? Or how can you get these micro-entrepreneurs or auto-own account workers, as we count them, how can you get those into the scope of the formal employment relationship? And there you have examples, for instance, from on that from Argentina, Brazil, Ecuador, Uruguay, for instance, who were trying to extend formal coverage by simplifying tax and social contributions, or monotax.
Yes.
So again, here you have
monotributo.
Monotributo, yeah. And here you have the issue that has actually been quite successful because it brought a lot of people in the formal labor market. Then still you have the issue with increasing the level because typically, but it's a first important step. And there I thought in the report that I read, one of the conclusions it said, I thought it was a bit too hard because you say fiscal incentives do not offer the self-employed any progress in terms of social protection. And there I thought, it's not, I get the point, it's not going to fix the problem by itself, but I still think that it shouldn't be dismissed as such. I mean, I think the point that the researchers wanted to make that is that you need a combination of measures, and that is what the other ones, yeah, that's what I want to say. Yeah, so this is what I have to say on that. Thanks.
Okay, so the social access to social protection, mandatory versus voluntary,
private and
public, for all or not for all, specific schemes.
Specific or selective.
Exactly. A big debate in the consultation for preparing this recommendation. That's also one of the reasons it's a recommendation.
We have a lot of recommendations. We are full of recommendations.
Yeah.
From
the ILO, from the European Commission, and so on. But in fact, there are a lot of what we have learned through this consultation is that there are a lot of different views, a lot of opposing views of how this should be tackled, at what level this should be tackled, if tackled at all, and so on. So the result of this was a recommendation that is now going into the Council. So this debate is not over, this debate is only starting. From our perspective, it is a debate that we need to have because things are moving fast and we need to adapt to this. Not only the social partners, but also sort of the policymakers. So there has to be a debate, but there are opposing views. And we know that we have the voluntary approach that is possible, but whenever we have a voluntary approach and whenever this voluntary approach is an opt-in approach, the take-up is usually not extremely high. So in that sense, the recommendation goes practically in all aspects for a mandatory approach. This is what we are recommending, with the exception, of course, for the self-employed in one of the aspects, because we are trying to look at a lot of different aspects of social protection. One specific there, the unemployment benefits, and because of this different nature of self-employed and different legal status, but especially different natures, it's very difficult to distinguish the link. To distinguish the unemployment risk from other risks, such as entrepreneurial risk. And this comes from the fact that we are, when we're talking about self-employed, we're talking about a lot of different forms of self-employed. So there, I think the Commission, and this is my personal opinion, was very brave in going for this kind of an approach.
Because what we stated with the research is an enormous fragmentation. Fragmentation means fragmentation within the countries and between countries. So different, very fragmented. So Your idea is that your recommendations are going in a convergent direction, or do you think that the specificity of each country and within each category could be maintained? Which is
where are we going? So we're this is an initiative that was proposed under the European Pillar of Social Rights, which is obviously about which we try to portray as a pillar that will bring us to upward social convergence. So we're trying to converge upwards, not in any direction possible. But of course, here we are in a world of social protection, which is where we need unanimity. So this is a policy area that needs an agreement for all to be able to implement it. We see that we have the mapping has shown there was a mapping taken for the preparation of the recommendation, which has shown that there are a number of different systems. Of course, member states are also a bit reluctant when it comes to this, because if we're not going to harmonize everything, first of all, it's impossible, but second of all, we will get no agreement on that. So in a number of areas, the recommendation is open. First of all, it's a recommendation. We are trying to achieve upward convergence in terms of labouring access, but also the adequacy, which again depends on the national context. Office of social protection, whereas the financing, the organization of the system is of course left to the member states. But one important point that was mentioned already is the transferability, because we see that we are changing different, that people are more and more changing not only jobs but also statuses, and that transferability needs to be ensured.
So yeah, at least I will defend the recommendation on social protection. Indeed, it's only a recommendation, it's also linked to the competences allowed by member states to the European Union, which are limited for sure on social protection. But I think that the principles behind this recommendation are feeding this recommendation and universality and transferability and transparency, which are really important. So we will see in the follow-up, there will be a strong political follow-up for the European institution. That could be another very strong element of the social policy that could be, that should be, that must be included in the EU governance, in particular in the EU semester, which is the follow-up process each year of national policy. That's a first example where the European institution and the Commission can prove that behind financial and economic issues or budgetary adjustment concerns, it also follows trends on social protection. So let's see, even if it's only soft law, how it will be recommended kindly to member states to approach improvement and to push for improvement. To also play the bad cop in terms of on poverty and employment, access to social protection is important. On the, to come back on the what you were talking about, the third statute. First, you know, it's a bit theoretical for me, because again, we don't need a third statute, but we need a definition of workers that includes as many statutes or situations as possible. Because I'm not sure whether we will create a third statute. Look at the situation of labor markets in Europe. There are far more many situations than three only. If you look at temporary workers, mini jobs, zero-hour contracts, part-time. I mean, there are situations in the labor market that are fragmented. So having a broad definition of what a worker is, including possible what we call in several countries, in Italy, in Spain, in France, autonomous workers, independent workers, is really important. And then there is no EU miraculous solution for the definition of a worker, but what we need is an EU definition, possibly established by a lower directive, that would enable stakeholders, it means trade unions, social partners, member states, to broaden the scope of social protection, to broaden the scope of collective bargaining, for example. I strongly believe that collective bargaining can be extended for employees, classical employees, but that also that self-employed should have access to collective bargaining in some cases. And that will be...
This is your third question, so we'll come back to that.
Sorry. So that's a...
Just to keep it. Okay. But this is your third question.
That's a warm-up for the next question.
Well, I think actually this question of social protection is probably more important than the first question we discussed. But nevertheless, I will get back to that one also for 1 minute, because reflecting what you said, Thiebaut, you mentioned the different forms of work nowadays, part-time, agency work, and so on, but all of these forms could usually quite easily be put either on the self-employment side or on the employment side. Agency workers, they are employed by the technical agency, so they are full employees. And we have
a European legislation.
And we have a specific legislation. We have a European definition of that, indeed, because we have a specific directive. But in most of the cases, it's quite clear. What you could discuss when it comes to the legal framework is to what extent we need to redefine what is an employee. Nowadays, as you know, this is based on the subordination contract relationship, which is defined by the fact that your boss can give you orders, they can control the execution of the orders, and they can sanction you if you have not done what you are supposed to do. I think this is something a bit of the past. Probably what the better criteria would be to what extent you are really autonomous at work or not would be probably a better criteria. But that's another discussion. Indeed, I agree the most interesting discussion is about social protection. Because nowadays you have more and more people moving from one form of work relationship to another one. Some people can be, you know, a full employee, and then they decide to create a startup, so they become, you know, self-employed. After another 2 years, the startup is failing, so they go back to an employment relationship. You have also more and more people handling several jobs at the same time. So you can have an employment relationship, but then I can do a bit of Uber, can do a bit of Airbnb, and so on. So you're actually, you know, mixing up different types of work relationship at the same time. And this is why what is important there is that to maintain some kind of stability in the access to social protection. So, and actually, if you look at, again, at the labor market of today, I think there are three main challenges to be tackled. And this is very much trying to reconcile the opposite, and that was already also been mentioned today, is how do you reconcile in today's labor market freedom and solidarity, individualization and collectivism or community, and diversity and harmonization or universalism. I think that's the three main important criteria. There is a very nice quote on the wall over there, I don't know if you've seen it, there are many ones. My favorite there is, we say it in French and then translate it into English, tout ce qui rend l'homme libre est bon. Everything that makes humankind free is good. So I would apply this principle to the social protection scheme. So I would go from my side for, you know, basic rights, flow of basic rights. That's the universalism. Everybody has access to the minimum. And then depending on who you are, what do you want, and maybe also your constraints, then you can go for, you know, supplementary, voluntary, additional social protection. Because there again, we have to recognize the diversity of the labor market, the diversity of the workforce. Not all self-employed workers are the same. They do not face the same constraints. They do not have the same rationale for being self-employed. And this we should recognize also for access to social protection. And finally, a reaction to what the ILO has said, because there is a beautiful report of non-standard forms of work. I don't know what is the standard form of work. At the global level, if you look at the ILO statistics, 60% of the global working population is working informally. So no formal labor contract, 60%. So the standard employment relationship at the global level, this is informality, this is working without any contract. My fear is that in Europe, it's a bit different, I agree, but that's the global report. That's the global report, yeah. My fear from the ILO is that, and this was also discussed earlier, that now we are trying to bring any new forms of work into the traditional standard one, which is supposed to be the standard permanent full-time contract, to to bring any other front into this framework, which is not the solution. We have to recognize the diversity of work relationships and that each form of work in a way has to have a specific framework.
Okay, so thank you for these 7 questions. So key words I think we can retain from this discussion, diversity of the situation, of the working situation, and maybe beyond the debate around voluntary versus compulsory protection system, it's a question of access, efficient and effective access. It's a question of transferability because of the diversity of the situations. It's also a question of enabling any kind of worker to access this protection. It's a question of transparency, to use the language of the European Commission, and so on. So it's an important step in our discussion. And then I would like to introduce the third one, knowing that Irene will have to leave us in 15 minutes, but so she will have to go.
Yeah, so as I said before, I would like that you try to focus more on self-employment, not on non-standard employment, all the world, etc., the developing economies, etc. So the debate, I would like that it stay more concentrated on self-employment and on Europe, because the third question, as I said before, is the probably the most important dimension of our research, the most powerful dimension, and the more studied one through the empirical evidences